Giovanni Forni. So let me first quickly remind you the. So I want to talk about the, some special case of polygonal billiard, and the. So the polygonal billiard is just the usual billiard motion, you know, law, the law of optical reflection. So this dynamical system is the polygonal billiard. Now the. Louder. So this dynamical system is example of the polygonal billiard. I think it's, you know, it will take longer time to write down carefully all the definitions, but this is how the system goes. So the motion of the particle with respect to the optical law, and if it gets to the corners, there the dynamics is not defined, but we ignore the corners, okay? And the essentially the theory splits in two parts. So if there are rational billiards that all the angles are rational multiples of pi, okay? This type of billiard is called rational. The lengths of the sides are not important, so the angles are important. In this case, almost everything is known, and the only remaining quotients are very special, very specific, okay? And the another case, if at least one angle is irrational, so not all of them, not all the angles are rational. And in this case, almost nothing is known, just very few things. And the main questions here are the following. There are three main problems here. The counting of orbits, namely the asymptotics of the generalized diagonals, which means how many orbits of length smaller than n connect the vertices. Here by length I can take both either number of reflections or geometric lengths. They are uniformly proportional. Okay. Second type of question is the ergodicity. The ergodicity is not known in general, and the existence of periodic orbits. In particular, sort of, I would say most famous problem in the area, that if you take the triangle with one angle greater than pi over 2, does there exist periodic orbit? This problem goes to 1775, because in this year it was proven that for any acute triangle there is this canonical periodic orbit. The ortho orbit is periodic. Okay, and since then it's not known if there is a periodic orbit for any general triangle. Okay, clearly nothing is known about four-gon, five-gon, and even for triangle is not known. Yeah, but not for general. For triangle is less than. There are partial results. Yeah.
And of course, if the angles are rational, then there are.
But I already mentioned that if the angles are rational, everything is known. I mean, what is not known, some very special questions. Okay, and if at least one angle is irrational, almost nothing is known. And ergodicity, because if the angles are all rational, then the polygonal billiard is obviously not ergodic, because any orbit can take only a finite number of angles if all the angles of polygon are rational. Just because when you reflect the orbit, you can write down the new angle in terms of the angles of the polygon, okay? So is they irrational? Only a finite number of possibilities. But if the at least one of angles is irrational, there is no such an obvious integral. So it's generally believed that the polygons are ergodic if at least one angle is irrational. Okay. So we started our paper with the result of there was some numerical experiment by physicists who actually tried to see if the numerically tried to see if the billiard in triangle is ergodic or not. So they did some experiments. They actually made a paper in the 2004, and they did the case of the general triangle, random triangle, numerically. And they did, independently, they did the case of the right triangle. And they found out the following, that the general triangle numerically is sort of clearly ergodic, and the right triangle billiard, irrational, is just ergodic, not clearly ergodic. So they tend to believe that it's ergodic. I have to say that why is this problem interesting for physicists? Because for the triangle of billiard, it's easily verified also numerically, all this fancy stuff about this quantum chaos, that if you take the solutions of the Laplacian, there are relations between lengths of periodic orbits, numerical, and the asymptotics of the eigenvalues. It's not proven. This is why the physicists are interested and make experiments. So they found out in 2004 that this is definitely ergodic. This is probably ergodic, okay? So, and the same group of physicists then did another numerical experiment. 10 years later, the same group did another numerical experiment only on the right triangle, because they sort of were not satisfied. Like, this is just ergodic, let's do it better. So they did some more computing power. And they found out numerically that it's not ergodic. They decided the irrational triangle billiard is typically, right triangular billiard is typically not ergodic. And they even referred to the, what? What? Rational, clearly not ergodic. So as they did the numerical experiments, they took some rational number, which they believed represents typical irrational number numerically. You cannot take a rational number, right? So, they picked some number on the computer. For this number, it seems to be not ergodic to them. Okay?
But you can't pick a rational number.
And you can't? If you do numerical experiments, everything is rational. But this sort of behavior seems to be not ergodic. Okay, so they took some irrational number on the computer, if you want. So, there isn't, but you know what I mean. Whatever this means, and they found out, but no, it's not ergodic. But and they even referred to their previous paper, where they proved that it is ergodic with the comment. Okay, see how it can happen. So we believe it's ergodic, but it's not. So, but I guess they published both papers anyway. So and then we with Giovanni decided to figure out what's happening. Anyway,
how do you show that something is not ergodic when it looks like?
If you take the circle rotation and take, say, the number, I don't know, 3/7, just take one number. On the computer, you take like 3/16, right? And take like take some finite rational approximation of root of 2 and take 10 to the 8 iterations, right? You will see a difference in behavior. Both the numbers are rational in the computer, but the distribution will be different.
You need to adjust the number of iterations.
Yes, sure. The precision here should be much better than here. Clearly. So this is what they did. They took like 20 digits here, and 8 to 10 digits here, and they see the differences in behavior. So that's what they did. Just take this number, you will have finite trajectory. Take this number, you will have some sort of, this is a computer experiment, right? It doesn't. Anyway, so we decided to figure out, and it turns out that we actually did experiment, and it turns out numerically that it is ergodic, but just numerically. But the rate of ergodicity is much smaller, and this is what I want to explain. So this is why physics were confused. They did not figure out how can it be that the rate of ergodicity here numerically is much smaller. Anyway, when you check the ergodicity for the billiard, you can so for any billiard, if you want to check the billiard ergodicity numerically, you can take just some test function and see the, you know, take the ergodic sum, see how it relates to the integral of the function. And normally you may take two test functions. You may take the small rectangle here and see how much, you know, how much time the trajectory spends here. But you also may take the some angular, so on the circle S1 of all angles, you may take some interval of the angles, and you may just see how many angles the trajectory assumes. So, and there was no problem with the coordinate ergodicity. So the coordinate function for irrational, for right billiard is well distributed in the irrational case. There was this problem with the angular function. So the angular function behaved sort of non-ergodically just because the angle changes here in the discrete way, because it depends on the angles of the polygon. And it turns out somehow the following things which confuse them, which I am going to talk about now, the number of different possible angles for the right triangular billiard grows very slowly. You see what I mean? To be ergodic in the angular direction, you have to take, to converge to the Lebesgue measure here, you have to at least have many points in here. But the point is that, and that's a different story if you converge to the Lebesgue measure or not, but you even have not so many points. The number of different angles grows very slowly. That's the point. So, in order to reformulate this phenomenon slightly, I will formulate what they actually verified slightly different language. So I'm going to do the following. So you take, say, first, to see the difference, like non-right triangle, you take two copies of this triangle, and you take one side, directed side on these two copies, and you glue them both side by side. So you glue this, so like, you just take two copies of triangles, you glue them. So what you get is this sphere with these three points in this chosen side. So this is a flat sphere with three sort of bad points where they all goes when they goes. And you have the geodetic flow on the sphere. So it's the same thing as the billiard. So you get billiard trajectory here. It's the same thing as to have a flow on this sphere, these three singular points. And what we want to do, we want to count the following number. So Sn, we want to take the following sort of random sequence Sn. You take a point on the sphere, and the vector going out of this point, unit vector. And you look on the following discrete sequence, like this, which is just the following. So you put any orientation on the sphere. This segment is oriented, this side of the triangle. And if you cross it with respect to orientation, you put plus one. Other way, you cross it in the other direction, counter orientation, you put negative one. So you get this sequence of numbers. And you want to see how this sequence growth. What's the, for randomly chosen point, you want to see the statistics of the sequence. So this is clearly related to the angular ergodicity. Okay. Now, if the triangle is not, so here's the what I want to talk about, the statistical anomaly, so to speak. So if the triangle is sort of even rational, you can do it even for rational triangles, because it's an independent problem, which in case of ergodicity related to it, but the problem itself is okay for rational triangles also. So, yeah, so for the general case, there is something which we can't prove, that this estimate is actually what would you expect from the toss coin. So it means there is no conspiracy. So it's the same thing as like if you toss the coin. for randomly chosen point and direction. Okay. This is what you would expect if you don't know anything at all. Like you toss the coin, you get this, right? But in case if you do exactly the same thing, if the triangle is right triangle, and you do the very same thing. So in the right triangle case, you have this sort of statistical anomaly. So it's a logarithmic growth. So it's growth, but logarithmic. So there is some conspiracy in the right triangular case, OK? So this is what I... Any questions so far?
So you think it's better?
No, I mean, in the irrational, in the non-right case, this is the distribution, right, of this sequence. In the right triangular case, the sequence grows very slowly, which basically means, if you reformulate it back to billiards, it means the number of different angles grows very slowly, because this thing, from the point of view of billiard, more or less counts angles. So this explains why the physicists think the billiard is not ergodic, because they don't see many angles, right? This is why they don't see many angles, because logarithmic growth of different possible angles. Like you take right triangular billiard, iterate the trajectory 1,000,000 times, okay? Take all the different angles which this trajectory could take. In the non-right case, it would be like 1,000 angles. In the right case, it's just the few angles. So they thought, the angles grow very slowly, okay? So, but as I said, the problem is defined even for, you know.
Let me ask a very stupid question.
Sure.
So take four copies of this right angle, arranged like in diamond.
So you go ahead. This is what I'm going to do.
Okay.
This is what I'm going to do. So what I want to do is, so for a rational case, it's still a conjecture. So what I want to do is to prove it for the rational case. So this is the, so for the rational case, it's a theorem. So if you take angle equals to P over Q pi, so theorem. Take the right triangle with rational angle. Play this game on the sphere, you will have this estimate. So I want to talk about the proof of this theorem. And then I will try to talk about what we try to do in the irrational case, okay?
So
almost every point, almost every direction in the rational right triangular billiard, you have this estimate. So, but for rational case, I will talk about. Anyway, so let me, for a second there, let me postpone, and then I'll get back. Let me postpone for the billiard, and I'm sorry for the numerous experts here. I will make a very quick introduction to the Techmill geodesic flow. Anyway, so I will start with the real vector space of the just the two-dimensional real vector space, like a plane. And there are lots of ways to make it into the one-dimensional complex space, which essentially means that you have to take the... So forget about billiard for like 10 minutes. So you have to put the almost complex structure on this space, okay? So any operator like this makes it a one-dimensional complex space. And imagine that you have two operators, like so. As you understand, this operator just gives you multiplication by I. So if you take two operators like this, it's a linear algebra fact that you can, out of these two operators, you can get this number coefficient k12 greater or equal than 1, so that there exists a special pair of vectors for these two operators, such that the first operator just takes one vector to another, and the second operator just takes this vector to the, so it's E1, E2, K12 of E1, okay? So like sort of they both normalized. Okay. And if you take have three operators like this, then you have the following inequality. So like you may estimate this. So if you take logarithm of this thing, then you get. Anyway, if you take logarithm, you see the triangle inequality, and you see that this coefficient equals to 1 if and only if it's the same structure. So clearly logarithm will be 0. So you have a metric space on the space of. So because of this inequality, you may take, actually you have to take 1 half logarithm of this k12. This is going to be a distance between j1, j2. Okay. I put 1 half here for the reasons which become clear a little later. Okay. So this formula gives you a metric space structure on the space of all almost complex structures on the real two-dimensional space, okay? So questions? Now, if you take the compact surface, well, some genus, you can even put some punctures on the surface. So some finite genus, finite number of punctures. You may consider the huge space. It's a huge space of all almost complex structures on the surface, which because there is some mean highest tensor, which will be zero identically in this case. Anyway, it's the same thing as complex structures in the case of dimension 2. So you have the operators. You have the operators on the tangent bundle, fiber-wise smooth operators. So this sort of disk represents all the possible space, all the possible almost complex structures on this smooth surface. Okay. And there are different groups. Well, there is the diffeomorphism group. Here on the surface, I put orientation, and I will always assume that surface is oriented, okay? So there is this diffeomorphism group, which acts on this almost complex structures. That just, well, because it's a tensor actually, right? So it just, I mean, if you take any F diffeomorphism from M, it acts on this space, okay? And there is a subgroup of this diffeomorphism group. So subgroup of this group, normal actually subgroup, the diffeomorphisms which are homotopic to zero. And you may take all these orbits of this group. So this orbit, so these things are the orbits of the group. So you take the, see? You put almost complex structure and deform it, but only by diffeomorphisms which are homotopic to zero. Okay. So these are these orbits, and there is this. So, on this between any two points in the space, there are almost complex structures, right? So you take two almost complex structures on the surface, right? In each point, you have a fixed tangent space on the point, so you have this difference, you have this distance between the two complex structures restricted to the point, right? You take maximum. So you take just if you do the, you know, distance between two continuous functions, you do the same thing. So it gives you a distance here, right? But what you want to take a factor of this space, and so I will have to. And I would like to define the distance actually on the factor space. I have to say that this factor space is exactly what's called the Techmiller space of genus G, as I said. Okay. So we take the set of all these orbits. So it's called a Techmiller space of genus G. Okay. So you factorize. So you take all the orbits by the diffeomorphism homotopic to identity. Okay. It's your Techmiller space. And there is a. I need to define the Techmiller deformation, which is the following. So you take the holomorphic quadratic differential W. You assume that you have the J almost complex structure. In this case, it's the same as the complex structure. You have a holomorphic quadratic differential W. Informally speaking, this is something which is locally, it's locally except zeros. So it's locally, it's a square of one form. So it has finite number of zeros. Outside zeros, it's a square of one form. And you make, so you have your original complex structure here. You pick any holomorphic quadratic differential. And you can make the following, what's called Techmiller deformation, using this quadratic differential, which is the following. You can find, well, ignore zeros for some time. Around each point, you can find a special set of coordinates, which are almost unique. I mean, they're a little bit not unique, which doesn't give any problem. Anyway, you can find a special set of coordinates where your holomorphic chart, where your differential becomes, well, plus minus dz, doesn't matter, okay? And here on this chart only, you may deform your complex structure on this chart. Namely, you may say that, well, this original complex structure moved this vector to another one. Like it moves E1 to E2. And the new complex structure deformed on this chart, it moves vector E to the T, E1 to the vector E to the minus T, E2. So it sort of shrinks, okay? And you can do it consistently. I mean, having quadratic differential, you can do it consistently on the whole surface. So it's a deformation, so for any time t, it's a deformation of the complex structure. And because you multiply by exponent, you see, consistently multiply, it actually means that there is a group action. Because, I mean, if you take 2 times t e s, so that you may combine e. It's the usual exponent, right? So if you t deform and then s deform, you have t plus s deformation, right? So you can deform. So having complex structure, quadratic differential, and any time t, you may deform these complex structures, okay? And this theorem of, if we return back to this picture, this theorem of Techmiller tells you the following, that if you take any two leaves on this diffeomorphism group, then there exists for each point on one leaf, there exists a unique another point on another leaf, and the quadratic differential here, sorry, which minimizes the distance, and moreover, exactly this, for this chosen quadratic differential here, exactly this time t will give me this Techmiller distance. This is why I divided by 2, that logarithm I divided by 2, okay? So this is called the Techmiller distance, so it's realized. So that's the Techmiller theorem, and one more. So I may talk now about the, actually what is interesting here, so when you want to prove that this factor space is a metric space, like here, right? So this, so each point here now is the whole, you know, leaf here. When you want to prove that it's a metric space, the triangle inequality is very easy. What is not easy is the distance is zero only if the points are the same, right? Because it could possibly happen that the leaves become very close, but to resolve it, you have to do a lot of Calderon-Zygmund stuff. Actually, I have to also say that I cheated, but not much. I technically cheated because the smooth the smooth actions will not be enough for you to prove exactly this zero thing. You have to actually, instead of diffeomorphism, you have to use so-called pseudo-conformal homeomorphisms, because if you don't use them, you'll not be able to prove that it's a metric space technically, but we can ignore these issues so far, okay? So we have the metric space, this Teichmuller space, and we have these deformations, Teichmuller deformations of the space, which you may think of it as of the following, that you take this point on the Teichmuller space, which gives you the equivalence class of the complex structures. And then for any other complex structures, it's like J1, J2, so up to equivalence, you know. For any other complex structure, there exists a unique W, the quadratic differential, and the time t, which allows you to deform, to make the Teichmuller deformation from one complex structure to another. Okay. Also, as this group, it's easily seen to be a normal subgroup, then we have the action of the factor group on this Teichmuller space, which is the, well, let's call it TG, the mapping class group. So you use mapping class group because, these leaves are orbits for only the trivial component, homotopy component, right? But there are non-homotopy. There are diffeomorphisms not homotopical to identity, which will be crucial for this proof for triangular billiard, which I get back soon. So there is this action of the mapping class group on the Teichmuller space. So it has sort of, well, I have to say, non-compact components. So the fundamental domain is non-compact. And obviously, this diffeomorphism action commutes with the Teichmuller flow naturally, because you take Teichmuller deformation, take diffeomorphism, or you may take diffeomorphism, take Teichmuller deformation, right? It doesn't matter. So this fundamental domain is exactly the moduli space. So each point here in the fundamental domain for this modular group action is the class of equivalence of complex curves, that's it, up to B-holomorphism. And so you have this Teichmuller flow on this space along any vector, and it projects nicely on the moduli space, okay? Okay, now I get to this what we have. Now I get back to the triangle. This picture I will leave for a while because I will need it a little later. When did I start? I start exactly at...
You started slightly later, so...
Okay. Anyway, I'm now going back to the triangle.
The important thing is that we should finish everything before...
Okay. No, I mean, I will... So as Misha suggested, I take this. Yeah, I take this. No, I'm okay. I take this right triangle and I reflect it 4 times. So now I get back to billiards. Once I did this very quick, insufficient introduction, I get back to billiards. So I take this rhombus. Okay. Clearly, the billiard and the right triangle, you see, right, it's... Well, you have to say correct words. It's the same thing as the billiard and rhombi after you say some, you know, correct words. And the point is that this is a standard procedure in the rational billiards. Sometimes it's called Katok-Zimnikov construction. You may, if you take a billiard trajectory instead of reflecting it, you may reflect the rhombus. Or if it was polygon, you would reflect the polygon, okay? And as the angle is rational, you just continue the trajectory, okay? As these angles are rational, there is only a finite number of possible positions of the rhombus on the plane. So So you reflect it anyhow along the trajectory, but there is only finite number of possible positions which you may identify. You may glue them by sides. And this way you get a compact surface of some genus, which, it's glued out from this rhombi, okay? And this, you put the rhombus on the plane like this, and you also have the, on this, you consider now that your rhombus was located on the complex plane, so you have this form dz here, right? And you can push it, or pull it out, whatever. Push it or pull it, depends. You can push it on the surface, which let me call it dz, right? Here some zeros of the form will appear because, outside these vertices of the rhombus, you're okay, but something happens and the technical thing happens on the vertical, on the vertices. So here, because when you start rotating the rhombus, taking all the possible positions, you cover the plane some finite number of times. Here you have a form dz. And you can just take the sort of take a ramified cover. Some zero will appear here when you pull back the form dz. So this is how the zeros of the form appear on the surface. Okay. Now, so you have this form, and you have this. You have this form dz actually. Okay. So it's even sort of better than the quadratic differential, but I will still need the quadratic differential a little later, okay? So you have this form dz. And what you do is, and you have this plane complex structure on the surface. So you have this complex structure on the plane because everything, the rhombus is on the complex plane, right? So you also pull it to the surface. So you have the So finally, you have a surface with the complex structure and with the one form, holomorphic one form, okay? So you may already start thinking about the Teich-Muller space and moduli space. So this is our surface, J, and here's this direction, which I call dz, right? And now I just want to reinterpret the problem and quickly show how it, gives the desired conclusion. So when I take this rhombus, I started with the sphere, right? And I counted the intersection of the trajectory with this sort of side of the triangle, right? The side of the triangle, once when you reflect this triangle four times, it will be this sort of thing, right? Now there is this finite set C. So on the surface, there is a finite set C. Surface is M, okay? There is this finite set C of the points on the surface, which are the vertices of this rhombus when you get to the surface, okay? And this cycle A, let me call this alpha. So alpha is the finite cycle. So alpha is the first relative group. It's just this finite union of all these sides. So the surface consists of finite number of rhombus, and we have this finite union of all these sides on the surface. This is our cycle alpha. Yes. Compact surface angle is rational. Yeah. So we have this cycle, okay? And it's not hard to show. Just little thinking that our trajectory, our Billiard trajectory, as I explained, becomes now some trajectory, possibly long trajectory on this surface, okay? And there is also this cycle alpha, okay? So one can see that you take the very long piece and you count it by the short non-important segment, okay? You call this long piece beta t. So t is your time as you go, okay? The time for the billiard flow. You have to close it by the very short segment, which doesn't give any contributions. My point is that this number then becomes. Yeah, so this number Sn, this plus 1 minus 1, in these interpretations, this number becomes more or less up to this short segment, which gives undesired contribution. It's just the scalp product of the alpha and beta t, okay? So this is what we essentially need to prove, that it grows less than logarithmically, okay? Because this cup product grows less than logarithmically. How do we prove it? This is where we use this action of the mapping class group. So in the Teichmuller space, we start with the point and the quadratic differential and shoot the Teichmuller flow. Okay. Well, this domain has a finite measure, as a matter of fact. So there is a natural measure on the Teichmuller space, which is infinite. And this domain has a finite induced measure. And what you can say is that the space of possible directions is also finite dimensional, right? Because the directions are actually quadratic differential. What I want to say is that, roughly speaking, well, it's not a proof, it's a rough sentence. So instead of showing that this is that it has a uniform logarithmic bound, instead of that, let me show the following: that there exists time moments Tn first, that there is a constant bound, uniform constant bound, but for some time moments, okay, not for all time moments, okay. How do you find these time moments? Okay, you see, I erased logarithm. I just put constant. Uniform constant, but for some sequence. Okay? So I put Tn growing sequence. So how do we do it? This is exactly where we use the mapping class group action. So as this space is sort of has finite measure, you may expect more or less for typical points, typical directions, it requires some work, but still, that this your original vector gets sort of close to this vector in the moduli group. So when you arrive after some time, you can find the diffeomorphism F such that you return back very closely. Okay? Closely means, well, take some compact subset, open compact neighborhood of this point, okay, you can return there. Okay, for typical choice of point and direction, right, by diffeomorphism. So on the Teichmuller space, you go away. But we're not on the Teichmuller space. We're on the moduli space. So you find the diffeomorphisms which get you back. Okay. Now you apply this diffeomorphism, and the intersection number is invariant clearly under the action of diffeomorphism. So you take this F, whatever it is, I call it F. Okay, some diffeomorphisms which on the moduli space, which goes back, okay, gets us back closely. So f of this intersection number is clearly the same number, right? I mean, it's a number, it's independent on diffeomorphism. But it's f alpha intersection f beta t, okay? So it's roughly the intersection of these two cycles, okay? And now the interesting thing happens. So how much time do I have? Oh, I'm about to finish, actually. So look, so we want to prove that this thing is bounded. We want to prove that this thing is bounded by some constants, right? So we apply some diffeomorphism such that this thing is bounded. So we want to prove that F alpha is small, relatively small, not very big. And this thing, F beta t, is not very big. Now, I start with F beta t, okay? And it's not going to be very big. Just exactly, this is how I chose F, I chose F in such a way, F is some sort of big diffeomorphism, right? I chose it in such a way that it returns the original differential close to the, it returns the final differential close to the original one, okay? So you, but you see this cycle? This very long cycle here, which I have on the surface, this cycle is approximately, well, more or less, Poincaré dual to the original or original extended differential. So roughly speaking, what happens here, I shrink the differential back. You see, you remember this differential was extended under Teichmüller law, so I shrink it back. Well, then the corresponding cycle is, it actually dual to the real part of the differential. It also shrinks back, more or less. So what I want to say is that this thing is small. Well, I could say you can compare it to one in the suitable norm, right? So the diffeomorphism shrinks this cycle back, okay? Now the problem is, the only problem is, and this is the, yeah, this is, so finally here I'm going to explain how the the fact that the triangle is right is used. It's right here. We want to show that this cycle is also small. You see this differential F, or this diffeomorphism F, it does something on the surface. We know that it shrinks this long wide cycle, right? But we have no idea what it does to this fixed orange cycle, right? And as a matter of fact, the F of alpha just equals alpha. This is what I want to quickly show, and then I will stop, okay? So you see what happens if I show that F of alpha just equals to alpha. The proof is done, more or less. I mean, the proof of this fact, because this is equals to alpha, this is small, cap product is small. So why is it equal to alpha? It's because of the following. I should say that the point is that we can choose this diffeomorph. The point is, if we take this rhombus, on this rhombus there is this natural involution. Call it, I don't know. See? It takes the rhombus and rotates it. And this involution turns out to be the involution, and it extends to the surface. And it turns out to be hyperelliptic involution on the surface. This psi, the rotation on the romb, the symmetry of the romb, extends to the hyperelliptic involution of the surface. And which means, actually, we can, because of this fact that there exists a hyperelliptic involution of the surface, this diffeomorphism we can take slightly better than usual. It's not just arbitrary diffeomorphism. We can take it in such a way that it commutes with the hyperelliptic involution. The reason is because we can actually consider the flow on the corresponding sphere. I mean, you take a factor of the surface by the involution, you get a sphere. We can consider the flow on the sphere and the normal and Teichmüller flow on the sphere with punctures, which is the factor. I mean, it's not important technical stuff. What I assume is that this like F psi, I assume that my F commutes with this hyperelliptic involution. I can do it. Okay, just one more condition. And now, look what happens. I'm taking F alpha minus alpha. So I want to show that it equals to zero. So why is this so? Look, on this surface, I take just this part of the cycle alpha. So just one segment of this finite number of segments. Okay, so I just take one segment. I can also assume, I forgot to say, that my diffeomorphism F, this is purely technical stuff, not important, that it fixes all these points. This I can also assume, not a big deal. So this is my alpha, you see, and my F, which did something good to this long cycle beta, it actually can do something very bad to alpha, F alpha. So you see, alpha is the fixed cycle. But F alpha can be very long. How come that this thing is is 0. It should be 0, right? It happens because of the following. Look, the f alpha minus alpha belongs to the H1M. So you see, when alpha belongs to the relative homology, H alpha, f alpha minus alpha belongs to the absolute homology. It's from this picture, it's clear, right? So it's a full closure. So it's not the relative anymore, it's the absolute cycle. Now I apply the hyperelliptic involution. So here I'm just doing the pure linear algebra. So I take so this question sign, right? So it's not proven yet. So I take this J of F alpha minus alpha. Well, it's J of alpha minus J alpha. It's F J alpha. So I here it's very important. Think ideologically. I use the fact that they commute. I use C. C, my hyperelliptic convolution. C, okay. So C of F alpha minus P alpha is F of P alpha minus P alpha. Well, alpha is alpha. What is alpha? Alpha is the you take all this rhombi, and this is your alpha, right? Because you remember how you got it. You take this triangle and reflect it 4 times. So this is your alpha. This cycle alpha obviously is invariant under hyperelliptic involution. So it's just the, well, it's just f alpha minus alpha. So you see what we got? We have psi of f alpha minus alpha equal f is equal to f alpha minus alpha. But psi is a hyperelliptic involution. And this cycle is in the absolute homology, not in the relative homology. So it should be anti-invariant. So hyperelliptic involution acts by minus one on the absolute homology. So it must be minus this thing. So this thing equals 0. So I prove that this f alpha equal alpha, and here I had cup product with S beta t, which is small. So I found the finite number of finite. I found the sequence of times tn, where the stn, the sequence of interest is smaller than some constant t, uniformly smaller. And how we get logarithm? This is a sort of folklore, canonical procedure. Think about the following. Think about the ideal case of the torus and sort of periodic Teichmuller geodesic, which is, you take, for example, take torus, take automorphism of the torus, okay? And the point is that torus has hyperelliptic involution. You can do it all, you can repeat all this on the torus, okay? And here the point is that the good times here, the times tn, which I found here, if you do all this stuff in the very particular case of the torus, you will see that those times which I found here, tn, in case of torus, they're more or less these times the multiples of the largest eigenvalue, okay? So you can take these times, you can take eigenvalue of this function, okay? And you can take these times, they will exactly, this matrix will renormalize everything, okay? So this matrix will exactly be this diffeomorphism in case of torus. It obviously commutes with the negative one, which is the hyperelliptic involution for the torus. And this will be the times. This tn, the times, which good times which I use here, will be exactly this lambda to the n. So finally, if you take arbitrary time, not the good time, you take arbitrary time, you should just write it down as the sum of the good times. There is nothing new here. This is classical in the area, okay? And you see, you write down what's the number of good times. It's just lambda in 1, lambda in 2. You know, you take sort of not the decimal expansion, but the lambda expansion. And you will see that the number of these good times is exactly the logarithm. So that's it. So this is how we get logarithm. It's clear for torus, more or less. The same thing is for the surface. So I don't have time to explain what we do in the irrational case, unfortunately, but thank you.